action plan. September the 25th, 1960. Darling family, sometimes it suddenly comes over me how strange it all is. Here I am, an ordinary person, doing what I've always wanted to do. Not stuck away in some horrid office out of the sunlight, but out in the open, sleeping under the stars, climbing the mountains, watching all the animals. Is it possible? Can it really be me? Or is it some strange hallucination? When I'm sitting up on what's now known as Jane's Peak, I can sometimes recapture what it was like to sit here when I was a young girl, when we knew nothing about the chimpanzees, but everything I saw was new and exciting. I didn't in the earliest days appreciate the scenery, not really, because I was so completely focused on seeing something exciting with the chimpanzees before the money ran out. We only had money for 6 months. And so it was chimpanzees, chimpanzees, and binoculars that weren't good enough. I mean, what a crazy idea, sending a young girl with no degree straight from England to what people thought was a potentially dangerous place and potentially dangerous animals. Of course I was sometimes scared if I heard a leopard nearby, because you're supposed to be. I mean, it's a bit stupid not to be, because then your adrenaline goes and you're ready to escape. But I just had this probably ridiculous feeling that I was here to do a job and that I wasn't going to be hurt if I was sensible and took the right precautions. So learning my way around all this whole area, finding the animal trails through the vegetation was just so exciting. And knowing that nobody'd done this before.
No, Frodo.
Chimpanzees were interesting. At first, when they saw me, they ran away. They're very conservative and they'd never seen a white ape before. As they got used to me, many of them became very belligerent. So they wanted me to go away. They would sway the branches above me. One of them actually came up and hit me on the head and make this savage call. This, we call it the rah. And that was a bit scary. But if I encountered a group like that, I would sit and not look at them and pretend I was very interested digging a hole in the ground or eating leaves, and I wasn't interested in them at all. When I first heard of Louis Leakey, I had no idea who he was. Somebody said, if you care about animals, you should meet Louis Leakey. He was a very well-known paleontologist, anthropologist. He wanted someone who had not got a university education. He wanted an unbiased mind. And he felt that somebody like that, learning about the chimpanzees and how they live out in the natural environment, would help him to better understand the probable behavior of the Stone Age men and women whose remains he'd been searching for all his life. Louis Leakey always felt that women would make better observers. You have to be patient to be a good mother. You need to be able to understand quite quickly the needs, the wants of a non-verbal being, and that's our own children before they can speak. Gradually coming to understand that the young ones with good mothers had a better start in life and were likely to go on and be successful in their communities. And realizing that this was very important for our children too. And I also saw how much fun the chimpanzee mothers had with their babies. And I thought, well, when I have a baby, I'm going to have fun too. And when I have a child, I'm going to give the child that early constant contact and reassurance that seemed to me to be so important for chimps.
If conservation had rock stars, this woman would be Mick Jagger, Bob Dylan, John Lennon, and Elvis all wrapped up in one. Dr. Goodall, David and I would like to present you with the Global Explorers Citizens of the World Award.
Thank you for that wonderful welcome, and you know, I want to say how honored I am to receive this award. And I can just say it in words, but if I were a chimpanzee, I'd say it very differently. When they're excited and they are, you know, celebrating something, I'm just going to show you what they would do when they receive something.
Get a picture of this.
Jane Goodall, three sentences, okay. Well, Jane Goodall is a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful person, beautiful soul.
Jane is, there's only one of her.
She's a star. She loves being a star. She loves being on stage. She loves sharing with people. But it's not from any grand ego. I think it's just from her. She has something to say, and she says it really well.
Many of you know Dr. Doolittle. Well, you probably just saw Harrison Ford in Dr. Doolittle, but I read the books. And there's that one way Dr. Doolittle takes animals from the circus back to Africa. And I loved that book. And then I found Tarzan. I was about 10 and a half. No TV in those days. It wasn't invented. So I read the books. And I read about this glorious Lord of the Jungle. And obviously, I fell passionately in love with him, as little girls of 10 or 11 do. And what did he do? He married that other wimpy Jane. At any rate, this was when my dream began. I would grow up, I would go to Africa, I would live with animals, I would write books about them.
Listening to her lectures, the way she can talk, the way she can really bring up the stories, I should say she's a unique person, and I simply call her, she's a walking angel.
And she does seem frail, but at the same time, she's tough as nails.
Someone with a tremendous presence, great vision, a wonderful sense of humor, infinite kindness, and extraordinary patience.
So, if we are arguably the most intellectual creature that's ever walked on the planet, how come we're destroying that planet? How come we're destroying our only home?